I will be going with him, and so will Juan Carlos Jaramillo in a forthcoming World Roots program. So, Juan Carlos, why don't you tell us what the last piece of music is that we're going to hear in this program from your trip to Colombia with José Hernando?
Well, I thought it would be nice just to rejoin the parranda, this party we had in the west of Bogotá. We had this fantastic rain and thunderstorm even. And, well, we here joined the parranda again when it was all in full swing. And we hear Egidio, the mentor, José Hernando's mentor, and one of the most important accordionists in Colombia. And by the way, he invited José Hernando to play, so we'll hear them in duet. And this is just Egidio persuading or trying to persuade our recording engineer, Andy, to leave his headphones aside, leave the recording aside, and join them in the party and actually do some dancing, which he did brilliantly.
Population mixed together the gaitas with the drums of the African people, and so then it became party music. And really, this music is at the roots of the Vallenato tradition that started much later.
It's interesting to see, Henry, that with your group Kumahana, you're discovering roots, you want to know about the past, but what's the role of your music in this Colombia of today, basically?
Colombia, sabemos que estamos azotados por la violencia.
Well, in the past few years, Colombia has been shaken by violence. That was the reason that Kumahana was formed. This neighborhood in Cartagena was badly affected by the violence. I was a music teacher then, and in 2001, the local government asked me to organize a music school for the kids in this neighborhood. So I was teaching the gaita to kids of 15 or 16 years old, and now the average age of the group is 25. And we have been a big influence on the neighborhood. Gaita music is lived, really lived here. You know, the violence affects us all. We all know someone, among our family or friends, who was touched by it. And that hurts. It really hurts. And there were members of our original group whose lives were changed. Some of them had gone down the wrong path, and they decided to put away their gun, go away from violence, and embrace our music instead.
Well, what you say is certainly really, really very, very touching. But at the same time, I have a feeling that through your story, it's very clear, for me at least, that music triumphs and that music in this context is certainly a tool for development and a tool for peace in the end, peace, reconciliation. So what are you going to give us now?
Okay, well, let's leave behind the sad moments. Let's go for something happy and spicy. A song called La Tigra, The Tigress. It's a fast song in the Vallenato Puya style, and it's a rhythm you just can't help dancing to.
This is our last day here in Colombia. We've come to Casablanca, a less than privileged district in the south of Bogota, and we're in a small studio, part of a house. It all looks a bit basic. There's a computer, small desk, small monitors, and as for the recording booth where we are at the moment, the acoustic treatment is made from an old carpet on the wall, some packaging material as well, but it's actually a perfectly decent multi-track studio. And this session has been set up by percussionist Alfredo Rosado. So, Alfredo, why don't you tell us, what are we doing today here?
Uy, muy contento y compañero de habitación y hemos charlado.
Well, I have just spent the last few days with José Hernando. We were living and working in the same house, and I was very pleased to accompany him on the caja drum. I am the regular caja drum player with Egidio Cuadrado and Carlos Vives. It was a great pleasure. He's a very good player. He can play very elegantly and slowly, and also very fast and in the new wave of vallenato playing. We learn a lot from each other, I think. But José told me he had composed a song himself, and I thought it was an excellent song. So I have arranged with some friends of mine to do a recording of it. So we are multitracking, and I am playing all the percussion parts. I have recorded the caja drum and the guacharaca already. Those are what you need in vallenato. Plus, we are adding congas and all kinds of other instruments.
Well, José Hernando, so far we've seen Alfredo recording bits and pieces, all the percussion separately, and it's your turn now to play the accordion. Why didn't you tell us what's happening now?
Well, the next step is to record the accordion, all the harmony side of the accordion, and then we record the bass side, because I think we're going to record separate, the melody side first, and then we record the bass side. So, yeah, we're just getting ready now. The sound engineer's fixing the levels up.
I know, he's really looking at us with a bit of anxiety. And But then you need to add the voice as well, your the singing part.
Of course, that's the last step.
And you've got lined up some singers as well to do the backing voices.
Oscar Pinzon is going to help us do the backing vocals,
yeah.
the
high ones and the low ones.
But tell us about the story of this song. When did you write it, actually?
Well, I wrote it. It was actually one day before coming to Colombia. I was inspired by this girl I saw. You know, I like her a lot, and I really want to tell her and express myself through this song. And this is how the song came up.
A week ago, basically.
Yeah, a week ago. Yeah. She's back in London. She's also Colombian.
She'll be pleased with the song, no doubt.
Aroma de rosa pura, lo digo en esta canción. Tus ojos negros me tienen loco, estoy contento y con emoción. Quiero decirte cuánto te quiero. Esta canción, porque eres linda y eres tan hermosa. Soy el poeta que te escribe esta canción, porque eres linda y eres tan hermosa. Soy el poeta que te escribe esta canción, porque eres linda y eres tan hermosa. Soy el poeta que te escribe esta canción, porque eres linda y eres tan hermosa. Ay, hombre.
Well, that's José Hernando's own composition called Hermosa, which means beautiful, in tribute to a girl he met recently. And there it was, having life breathed into it in a modest studio in a neighborhood in the south of Bogotá. So, José, my obvious question to you is, how's it going with the girl?
No, it's going very well, actually.
Has she heard this song, Hermosa, dedicated to her?
She heard it and she was very shocked at the beginning. She didn't actually expect this, but she said, oh, you're so sweet, and you know.
Romantic,
yeah.
That's very nice. But it sounds to me slightly different from the kinds of vallenato that we've been hearing so far that you've been recording while you were in Colombia.
Definitely. Well, I decided that this song that I made fitted perfectly with the romantic side of vallenato now. It sounds more commercial as well.
Is that because of the bass?
The bass and the keyboards and also the bass guitar.
Well, the next step in the mentoring of José Hernando is going to be to take him to the festival, the great Vallenato Festival up in Valledupar, the Festival de la Leyenda Vallenata.
Oh, good and evil.
La vida, es la lucha por la vida.
Yo soy Enrique Martínez, el que nunca tiene miedo si se trata de tocar. ¡Hey! Oiga, mi muchacho, yo soy Enrique Martínez, el que nunca tiene miedo si se trata de tocar.
Luis Enrique,
el pollo vallenato,
es candela
lo que van a llevar.
Luis Enrique,
el pollo vallenato,
y es candela
lo que voy a tocar. Oiga, muchacho, oigan la nota, como toca el vallenato.
Oiga, muchacho.
acordeón en la mano dispuesto para tocar. Salgo a la calle con mi pañuelito rojo y mi acordeón en la mano dispuesto para tocar. ¡Ay, Luis Enrique, el pollo vallenato! Oigan muchachos, oigan la nota, cómo toca el vallenato. Oigan muchachos, oigan la nota, cómo toca el vallenato.
Colombia's big star, Carlos Vives, recording a special session for World Roots there in his own restaurant, Gaira, in Bogotá, with his band. And the accordion that you heard was none other than our 2012 World Roots Academy protégé, José Hernando. Wow, fabulous sound. It must have been a great event.
It was very nice seeing these musicians, engage and see. They were actually enjoying it with me. So I was.
And were you enjoying yourself with them?
Of course. I'll be honest. At the beginning, I was a bit nervous. Oh, man, these guys are very professional. But then, I got used to it. Nah, put the flavor, and then I just forgot about all the nervous. It was all fun afterwards.
Yeah, you can actually really hear the funness in the sound of that, Juan Carlos.
Oh, it was wonderful. It was just the spirit of a parranda, but done in Bogotá. And it was great to have Carlos Vives in such a nice spirit. He welcomed José Hernando with his open arms, really.
When I met him, he was very kind. He's a very kind person. He actually joked with me backstage. He was telling me, we have to chuck José, the musician, we have to chuck José to the Guatapurí River. That's like baptizing him to the pure vallenato. Even if it's very cold, you have to you have to stay there. And
that's a river that goes through Valledupar, the cradle of vallenato.
Juan Carlos, I gather that while José stayed on and continued to be mentored by Egidio Cuadrado, his mentor, that you went up for a trip to the Caribbean to hear some different kinds of music.
Indeed, and we tried to explore this paradox of Colombia, of two different cultures, mainly broadly speaking, that exist in Colombia. We came from the Andean culture of Bogotá, high up in the Andes, where people seem to be more serious, serious-minded. There's not so much room for joking and pulling people's legs and that sort of thing. And going to the opposite side of the country, to the Caribbean coast up in the north, which is the absolute opposite. It's where people are jolly, jumping at them up and down, where things are much more relaxed, of course. So Cartagena provided the perfect atmosphere for us to explore a bit of that Caribbean spirit in Colombia and to have another look at the context in which vallenato flourishes so
because
much.
Because you would describe vallenato as a Caribbean music.
Oh, indeed. Vallenato is mainly a Caribbean expression, and it encapsulates everything that Caribbean means in the Colombian context.
And what did you find when you went up to Cartagena?
We visited this poor, I wouldn't say shantytown, but certainly a marginal part of Cartagena, where there's some people trying to go beyond music because they're working with people that are underprivileged and are more exposed to violence, to crime, to all those things. And through music, they're literally offering them, maybe a better future.
Mi compadre pone en el
that's a song, El Ya Sabe, that can be translated roughly into, He Who Knows. And we're here in the neighborhood of San José de los Campanos. We're with Henry González, the founder of the group Kumahana. This is a group of gaitas. Henry, can you tell us exactly how the group was formed?
Bueno, nosotros somos la Corporación Cultural Kumahana.
Kumahana is a word that means with the people, and our aim has always been to find the roots of the people's music, the people's heritage. And we think that the most important part of this heritage is the indigenous flute, the gaita. Around Cartagena and around northern Colombia, the gaita has been played for centuries, and so we want to understand the roots of this music and do something new with them.
So if you want to concentrate, as it were, on the pre-Columbian, pre-Hispanic roots of the gaita's music, how do you do your research and how do you actually know how this music sounded, ages ago?
This music goes back to early times. It was never written down. There are no descriptions of it. Instead, it was just handed down through the generations. We think the gaita started with the Kogi Indians, who still live in Santa Marta region of the northern Colombia, and they still play the gaita. They use the gaita in the ritual worship of the sun god and the water god, so it had a spiritual use. Then the Spanish came, and they brought the slaves from Africa here to Cartagena.
Well, the excitement is growing now in the gaita, and two other accordionists who happen to be at the restaurant have asked if they can join in. Fortunately for us, one is Jorge Rojas, a very respected maker and player from the other side of Bogotá, and the other one is an outrageously over-talented 14-year-old called Daniel Dani Maestri. Here they are in the traditional song La Vieja Sara, Old Sara.
Tengo que hacerle a la vieja Sara una visita que le ofrecí. Tengo que hacerle a la vieja Sara una visita que le ofrecí. Pa' que no diga de mí que yo la tengo olvidada. Pa' que no diga de mí que yo la tengo. Su collar. También le traigo su regalito, un corte blanco con su collar. Pa' que haga un traje bonito y pa' que te por el plan. Pa' que haga un traje bonito y pa' que te por el plan.
La Vieja Sara, on a fantastic and very lively merengue recorded in Carlos Vives' restaurant. And I'm still here with Carlos Vives, Vallenato superstar in Colombia. And there's no doubt that you've become a huge success, not only in the country, but certainly internationally. You've just came back from Nicaragua, I'm told, just last week playing there, and you still are doing lots of concerts abroad. How do you feel being the Colombian ambassador of Vallenato abroad?
Well, when I started, the artists who were seen as my main competition in Latin music were artists like Tito Puente, Celia Cruz, La Fania, and Cachao López. Now this was strange, because they were all much older than me. And the wonderful thing was that they were all so generous and encouraging to me, seeing this Colombian boy taking the Colombian tradition to the Latin world. And Cachao once said to me, "You know, the most beautiful thing you have done is to share the musical richness of your country." And that was like gold to me. It did me so much good. And they all said the same thing. They were really encouraging.
But it's interesting what you say, this reaction of the foreign, of these foreign big names. Because for me, maybe for a foreigner interested in Colombian music, there may be two kind of paradoxical universes, as it were. There is on the one side the Colombian, which has been sadly suffering from such a lot of violence and difficulties in the normal life. And on the other hand, this Colombian music, which rarely acknowledges that violence. And how do you see this kind of two different worlds that Colombia manages to have really through its music and through its life?
Sí, una pregunta muy interesante. Porque si hay historias en el vallenato, si hay historias en...
Well, yes, there have been many wars in Colombian history. We think of the tragedy of the local indigenous populations, of the African slave, of our many civil wars and internal conflicts, or more recently, the drug wars. Yet, ordinary people in Colombia have a special gift, that however bad things get, they are always positive, always optimistic, always happy. They feel everything so strongly, they fall in love madly, and I think this is the part of the Colombian spirit. There is so much kindness. They even give of themselves to people more wealthy than them and not expecting anything back. This is what it is to be Colombian, and this is what I'm trying to celebrate in my music, this Colombian spirit of exultation.
So, Carlos, let's go back to this Colombian liveliness, this joie de vivre, with one final song called El Pollo Vallenato, which is translated by the Vallenato chicken or cheek. And in this song, we actually feature our very own World Roots Academy mentee, José Hernando Arias. It's a beautiful song.
Pienso que José está tocando muy bien.
Well, I think José Hernando is doing great. Actually, he could be the chicken in the Pollo Vallenato. The song was written by Luis Enrique Martinez, a celebrated, legend and live accordion player and composer who said, "I'm the top chicken in town. I'm the best." He fancied his chances. But like so many Vallenato songs, it's about something deeper too. It's about relationships, about finding your place in life. And that's where the accordion became popular. I also used to hear the folk music from around Cartagena. Then, when I was older, I started my acting career in TV soap operas. I first became famous for playing the role of a boxer. They wanted me to sing in these telenovelas too, and these songs were mostly romantic ballads.
So doing this soap opera about Rafael Escalona, the very famous Vallenato composer, actually provided your breakthrough in terms of your musical life. Really.
Claro, porque yo había tenido la experiencia de trabajar con las baladas. Digamos que
absolutely. That was a huge milestone for me. That was a big success, and after all the ballads I'd been singing, playing this role made me go right back to my roots. And there I was, singing Escalona's song with a traditional group. That's where I started to work with Egidio Cuadrado, by the way. So it was like coming home, but after all the clash of musical experiences I'd been having, I was able to find a new and fresh way of singing my home music. You know, people get obsessed about ideas of traditional music and folklore. I say you can't really get back to a time where there was no electricity and no communication. So there is no point in trying to replicate something from the past. What I try to do is understand the soul of folklore and then take it somewhere else that is right for our time.
It's time now to hear one of your songs, one we've recorded here in session in your restaurant here in Bogota. which is called Carito and happens to have some lyrics in English. Would you tell us about this song?
Carito is the hideous bullshit. Because never learn English. Tell me, yes, I learn English in my little country, in my little town in Villanueva, Guajira, the Columbus Americana. No, not really. Never learn English.
What happened was, Egidio Cuadrado and I were talking about our failed efforts to learn English, and so we decided to write this fantasy. A beautiful fantasy about an American woman from Boston who tried to teach English to Egidio at the Colombo American Institute in Villanueva, Guajira. In the song, I tell how Egidio couldn't pay attention to her lessons because he'd fallen in love with her. Everyone thinks it's a true story, but actually, it's Egidio's lie. It's just a bit of fun. There's never been such an institute in Villanueva at all.
Una gran fantasía.
Pensaba yo en estos tiempos de incomprensiones y desencanto, de tantas buenas razones para soñar sin desfallecer. Y pensaba con nostalgia de la inocencia de aquellos años y esos primeros amores que al recordar vuelven a nacer. Y recuerdo en mi memoria aquellos tiempos de Carito. Ella era una niña de Boston que daba clase en la escuela. Le gustaba el español y aunque lo hablaba poquito, esos ojos bonitos que hablaban muy bien por ella. Carito me habla en inglés, qué bonito se le ve. Carito me habla en inglés, qué me dice yo no sé. Carito me habla en inglés, qué bonito se le ve. Carito me habla en inglés, qué me dice yo no sé. Egidio, don't be like that now, listen to me, you will pay attention. I need you to write in English, muy perfecto paragraph. Tell me, what do you learn? Don't need to aprend there to be tan coquete, Egidio. Remember, nothing a cordial until you finish the work you have. Le daba una sonrisa, yo me quedaba loquito. Y después en el examen lo ponía todo al revés. Carito se fue del baile, yo la recuerdo cantando.
de Colombia.
So that was Carito recording in a special session for us here in Carlos Vives' restaurant, actually. And I'm here with Egidio Cuadrado, the World Roots Academy mentor, and we now actually learned that he co-wrote Carito, this brilliant song. Now, Egidio, how do you feel about this thing of when the singer is king these days?
No, nada de eso. Lo que pasa es que son cosas que suceden en la vida anteriormente.
Well, in the old days, the accordionist was always the singer, too. Then, in the early 1970s, it began to change, and you started to see separate singers. Now, all the attention is on the singer. It's a new way of doing things, but at least it gives us accordionists a chance to focus on just playing our instrument, so I really don't mind that. The big annual Vallenato Festival is different, though. The singer has to be the accordionist, or maybe one of the percussion players.
Now, Egidio, I remember when the Clásicos de la Provincia No. 1 CD was released, people criticized a lot the CD because people thought that it was going completely away from tradition and especially away from the role of the accordion, which actually is your instrument, and it was your own playing in all this work with Carlos Vives.
Let me tell you what happened. Carlos Vives had been very successful as a TV actor and a singer too. And when he was asked to do a soap opera about the Vallenato composer, Rafael Escalona, he asked me and my group to play for him. We had two CDs released from the series, and they did very well. Then Carlos announced that we were recording the Clásico CD, with mostly traditional songs played with members of his rock group. And the reaction was really bad. I just said to people, give us a break. Just wait until you have heard the album before you criticize it. And you see, we did everything with complete love and respect for Vallenato. And when the album came out, people loved it. And not just in Colombia, Maradona was dancing to Vallenato. They loved it in the whole of Latin America. And we hope the British people will soon be dancing to the Vallenato rhythm too.
And now, Egidio, what do you think that Carlos in particular has brought to Vallenato?
Mi compadre Carlos lo ha aportado todo.
It's what I say, really. I'm not just saying this because I'm his accordionist, but my friend Carlos is the one who has really made Vallenato popular throughout Latin America. Before him, Vallenato was just a rather local folklore music coming from one country region of Colombia. But now it's truly international. And people who are experts of this kind of thing say that the way he sings Vallenato is both perfectly contemporary and perfectly traditional too.
I know, and it was great. It was a great night, and they played together for, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 hours. And the whole party was great. We even ended up dancing. And this particular number, which is called Matilda Lina, it's one of the most famous compositions of Leandro Díaz, which is a remarkable composer. And in this song, in this particular verses, he says, when this woman walks, she's so beautiful, she's so fantastic, that even the savanna smiles.
Chiquitico, chiquitico de melodía, ni una nota ni recogida, me parece hecho mío, era que estaba en el río, era que estaba en el río, de está pendiente que la sabana deja una hembra muy popular. Es elegante, todo la mira. Cuando Matilde camina, está frente a la sabana. Cuando Matilde camina, está frente a la sabana.
Es muy bueno el aguacero.
We're about to meet Carlos Vives, one of Colombia's superstars. Although he was born on the Caribbean coast, he moved here to Bogotá as a child, to this house in a rather well-to-do neighborhood. The place has been transformed into a successful restaurant run by his family. And most nights, musicians give live performances here, including, of course, Carlos himself, but even Shakira has played gigs here. Now, for a special BBC session, Carlos Vives has gathered members from his group La Provincia, which features the accordion of Egidio Cuadrado, World Roots Academy mentor. So let's join them in the classic song La Gota Fría.
Moralito de aquel día que estuviste en Urumita y no quisiste separada. Te fuiste de mañanita,
sería de la misma rabia.
Te fuiste de mañanita,
sería de la misma rabia.
En mi nota soy extenso, a mí nadie me corrige. En mi nota soy extenso, a mí nadie me corrige. Para tocar con Lorenzo,
ya de sábado día la Virgen.
Para tocar con Lorenzo,
ya de sábado día la Virgen.
Ay, me lleva él o me lo llevo yo,
pa' que se acabe la vaina.
Me lleva él o me lo llevo yo,
pa' que se acabe la vaina.
Ay, Morales a mí no me lleva,
porque no me da la gana.
¿Qué cultura va a tener un indio yumeca como Lorenzo Morales? ¿Qué cultura va a tener
si nace en los Cardonales?
Ay, ¿qué cultura va a tener
si nace en los Cardonales?
Cero para Lorenzo Miguel,
que me trato de embustero y más embustero es él.
Ay, que me trato de embustero
y más embustero es él.
Me lleva él o me lo llevo yo,
pa' que se acabe la vaina.
Ay, me lleva él o me lo llevo yo,
pa' que se acabe la vaina.
Ay, Morales a mí no me lleva,
no me da la gana.
Moralito a mí no me lleva. Moralito se creía que la Mimi iba a ganar. Y cuando me oyó tocar, le cayó la gota fría. Y al cabo de la compartía,
el tiro le salió mal.
Y al cabo de la compartía,
el tiro le salió mal.
Mal.
La Gota Fría, one of Vallenato's most famous songs, in a session recorded here in Carlos Vives' restaurant, actually in Bogotá. And we're happy to be with Carlos right now. I'd like to ask you, Carlos, about the kind of music you heard when you were a little boy.
Bueno, en especial la música que llegaba al Caribe, de ese Caribe Sur donde somos en Colombia.
Well, I grew up in Santa Marta, on Colombia's Caribbean coast, and on the radio, apart from local music, we could hear songs from Mexico and Cuba, and all sorts of Latin music. But I also heard British music, like the Beatles, on the radio too. But most especially, my parents loved Vallenato music, and they used to hold parrandas in our family home, where Vallenato musicians, just like the old troubadours, would come and play for us and our friends. Santa Marta is near the Guajira region of Colombia.
It's the rainy season in Bogotá at the moment, and this was the setting for the first of our World Roots Academy visits to Colombia. This year's protégé, José Hernando, has just come back from a week in Colombia with his mentor, one of the country's most celebrated accordionists, Egidio Cuadrado. This is a third of this year's World Roots Academy programs. So far, following the launch in January, we had a studio session program where we found out a lot more about José Hernando and the background to the music tradition he plays, called Vallenato. In the next hour, we'll hear about how José got on in his lessons with his mentor in Colombia, and we'll learn what happened at a special BBC recording with one of the country's biggest stars, the singer Carlos Vives. And there'll be music from the north of the country, including the indigenous gaita flute. And here's José and Egidio together, recorded in a country house just outside Bogotá, playing at a typical Colombian late-night improvised music session called a parranda. Hear more about what was really going on at that parranda in a moment. Now, for various reasons, I wasn't able to go on this trip, so instead we sent Radio 3's own resident Vallenato expert, producer Juan Carlos Jaramillo. So I'm hoping to hear a full and frank report from Juan Carlos and José as they're with me in the World Roots studio. So, José, tell us about how the mentoring sessions went.
It was very great to play with these virtuoso players, Eder Polo, Guacharaca, scraper, Caja Player, Alfredo Rosado, drum. It just changed the way I play as well. You know, I just felt a difference instantly. Yeah, Alfredo Rosado, which is the Cajero player, even he told me, we both learned from each other. You know, you have learned your skills and even I have learned from you.
So oh, that's nice.
It was very great, you know.
In that case, it's not just that you're learning from your actual mentor, who's Egidio, but from all the musicians
around. You can just tell that flavor, you know, sabor, how we say.
One of the things about this music is that the accordionist is also very often the singer. And you're singing as well as playing the accordion. So what did you learn in terms of song?
The breathing techniques. I still didn't have that. It's helped me actually in pitch, because my voice is kind of a low voice. So when it comes to singing and hit the high notes, I had difficulty with that, with the explanation Egidio gave me. And also Carlos Vives, when I got to meet with him, he showed me a few techniques backstage. So this really helped me.
And Juan Carlos, being a Vallenato player and aficionado yourself, what was it like for you? What was the experience like?
the trip explained what the World Roots Academy is really all about. This whole spirit was there from the beginning to the end. And from José Hernando, we've heard already how the trip was very fruitful in terms of all the music he learned. But also, it was great to see him in this culture, you know, the culture of the land of his parents, and the exploring and getting closer to the roots that he really wants to make his own, that he's embracing so nicely here in London. So it was great. And one last point that we mustn't overlook, really, it's the reaction of the players themselves to José Hernando, because the players at the beginning of K, they were saying, okay, this guy comes from the UK, he plays Vallenato, he says he plays Vallenato, but at the end, José Hernando, he really managed to persuade them that he is a true Vallenato player and that he represents the Vallenato tradition in the best possible way. So it was exciting. A fantastic experience for everybody, really.
But tell us, Juan Carlos, tell us what the country house was like where the mentoring sessions took place, because I gather it was pretty wonderful.
Pretty stunning, really. But you have to take in account first that Bogota is the capital of the country, and it's really high up in the Andes. It's actually 8,700 feet above sea level. And the experiment of going to this country house, in a way, which was a hideous idea, and I thought it was great, was fantastic, was to travel. It's about 60 kilometers or 70 kilometers, some 50 miles, 40 miles away from Bogota to the west. But it means a quite abrupt descent through the mountain, through a really winding and stunning views, of course, and just to go to a tropical paradise. And it represents that exuberant vegetation, lots of fruits around, the weather is fantastic, and definitely the music of Vallenato suits this place fantastically. You really want to live life when you listen to this music in that particular atmosphere.
So tell us about the parranda.
So parrandas are the main expression of Vallenato, if you like, are the Vallenato parties, and the idea is that people gather together, sitting down, and different accordion players come, or different singers, and the party starts, and people sing all these standards of Vallenato or new songs or what have you, and people end up usually improvising songs or verses to these traditional melodies. And this is the spirit of the parranda. And
so very spontaneous
party. definitely very spontaneous. Mm-hmm. And because it's very long, of course, you need lots of food and maybe one or two drinks as well to properly enjoy it.
I mean, I've heard about drinks like chicha and so on, which are made from corn, I think. Is that right?
It is, up in the Andes.
Is that the sort of drink you're talking about?
No, of course not. The tradition in Valledupar is just to drink Scotch whiskey of all drinks. I'm no expert.
Perish the thought. Good
but,
Lord.
But in honest truth, it's something that most people really enjoy in that climate. I know it's very much like we were saying, that music fits that atmosphere. Whiskey fits that thing like no other drink would suit the Vallenato music.
In the midst of the parranda, there was some playing by Egidio Cuadrado, the mentor, and by our protege, José Hernando.